So we're happy to include our partner campuses at UC Davis, UC Merced, and UC Santa Cruz on the recording and webcast today. Thanks for joining us for lunch if you were able to. Everything is compostable except probably the plastic saran wrap, so you can toss everything in the bins in the back when you're finished. So a couple of quick announcements about Citrus Foundry. You probably know the Citrus Foundry is the startup accelerator program that we run, and their deadline for new teams is coming up soon. Their applications are due on March 26th, just before midnight. So take a look at citrusfoundry.org for more information about that. We would love to have you involved. And if you want to find out more about the Foundry and about some of the great teams that are coming out of it before the application deadline, we're having a demo day a week from today in the evening here in the Bonato Auditorium. So take a look online for that as well, and I hope that you might join us. It's really inspiring to see what these six teams that are graduating this year for demo day have accomplished and where they're going. So before I introduce our speaker, I also just want to highlight another upcoming event that's related to Wikipedia. I noticed the other day that the Art and Design at Berkeley Group is hosting an edit-a-thon on March 21st in Moffitt Library in the afternoon, 1 to 6 p.m. So please take a look at that if you're interested in really diving into Wikipedia. If you haven't been an editor already, they'll make it easy and will provide snacks. So that always makes it attractive. So let me introduce our terrific speaker for this afternoon. Leila Zia joined the Wikimedia Foundation in February 2014 as part of the research and data team. She received her PhD from Stanford in management science and engineering, and her current research interests are on understanding Wikipedia's readers, quantifying and addressing the gaps of knowledge in Wikipedia and Wikidata, and understanding contributor diversity and its challenges in Wikipedia. So please join me in welcoming Leila Zia.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thanks for having me here. A few things before I jump in the talk. One is that it was beautiful to come back to Berkeley this morning as I was driving back to campus. I live not so far away from here in Sunnyvale, and I work in San Francisco, and for some reason, I think for the past 3 years, I have not been back to Berkeley. And it was beautiful to see the whole scenery. I think it's right now is also a perfect time with spring, like all the colors and everything. It was great to see the campus at full force. Again, thanks for having me here. I also want to say two more things. One is that what I'll be presenting to you, the parts that are research and statistics and science, as far as we can say, are facts that I think everyone will stand behind, including the researchers and Wikimedia Foundation and anyone who listens to this talk. But there are things that I will say in this talk that are my views based on the research that we have done for the past 2 years on this topic. These views are not necessarily the views of Wikimedia Foundation, but also not views of necessarily the views of Wikimedia editor community. So I want to flag this because it's a video that is being recorded and people watch it later. And I should not be considered a source of authority on what I say on my views. And lastly, this is a relatively long talk. It's a 40-minute talk. So if there is something that I say that stops you from understanding what I'm talking about for any reason, please raise your hand and ask your questions. For the people who are online, I think this will be harder in this case. I think we don't have any online monitoring of those who are joining remotely, but at least for the people in the room, we will have a chance to clarify things as we go on. Okay, so today I'm going to talk to you about growing Wikipedia across languages via recommendations. And I want to start the talk usually by getting a sense of people in the room. So, very easy question. How many of you have used Wikipedia in the past week? Okay, I would say almost everyone. I think I got 98%. And that's good. Wikipedia is the biggest encyclopedia in human history, as you all know by now. It contains more than 43 million articles across more than 200 languages. 160 of these languages are actively edited by editors every month. It has around 60,000 volunteers that come to the website every month to create and maintain content across these languages. And it's viewed by humans 6,000 times per second. Every second, We have these many people coming, and these are people, bots and spiders excluded, who come to Wikipedia to read Wikipedia articles. We go for a variety of reasons to Wikipedia, for different levels of information needs. Sometimes we go there because we want to do a quick lookup about the population of Berkeley. Sometimes we go there because we want to learn an overview or summary about California. And sometimes we go there because we want to do deep learning. We want to go in depth and learn from the knowledge that is available on the encyclopedia. We go there with different motivations. Sometimes we are triggered because we have watched a movie or listened to a talk show on radio. Sometimes we go there because we are interested in intrinsically learning, for example, about Spanish culture. Sometimes we go there because we have a homework due tomorrow or a work project that we have to hand in tomorrow, right? And sometimes we go there simply because we are bored or we are just curious and we want to learn. Wikipedia in the past decade has become our destination for accessing encyclopedic neutral point of view content across many languages and many topics. And yet, this Wikipedia is incomplete. And I want to take the next few minutes to show you why it is incomplete. So this is the map of the world, and what you see here is basically a series of dots going from basically black, blue, all the way to white. The points that are shown by white, these are points, basically geo-coordinates for which we have at least 10 Wikipedia articles. So what you see is that the western part of the US and eastern part of the US and West Europe has many white dots, and that means in every point in that geo-coordinate, we have 10 or more articles on Wikipedia. Of course, these are articles that can be geolocated, right? So if we're talking about buildings, cities, rivers, things that can be associated with the map of the world. This is not the whole knowledge on Wikipedia. And as you go basically from the white color all the way to the darker colors, what you see is a reduction in the number of Wikipedia articles. The points that you see blue, if you can see it clearly down here, these are the points for which, geo-coordinates for which we have one Wikipedia article. If it's black, we have nothing. So this is on English Wikipedia. It's a language that's spoken natively by more than 500 million people, right? And what you see is that there are largely densely populated areas in the world that we have no coverage on Wikipedia on. So for example, if you look at China, India, Sub-Saharan Africa, and even northern parts of Africa, and then Southern America. And this situation gets worse as you go to other languages, which, by the way, are not necessarily all smaller languages compared to English. And by the way, Berkeley is up here, and it's white, I checked. But that's because California has a lot of coverage, right? And Berkeley is a place that many people come, many people visit, many people are excited about. The university is here, so there's a lot of chance for articles to be created about this region. So let's look at Russian Wikipedia. Russian is a language that is spoken by 250 million people as native speakers of Russian. And what you see is that if you can only speak Russian, this is how much Wikipedia can teach you about the world, about the geo-coordinates of the world and what's happening in there. You can basically learn about Russia and eastern part of Europe, some parts of Western Europe, and that's about it. If you speak Spanish, and that's the only language that you speak, this is how much Wikipedia can teach you. What you see is that Southern America is pretty dark still, and that's surprising, because that's a continent that has a lot of native Spanish speakers. You may say that, okay, Southern America is pretty dominated by Brazil in terms of area, but the situation doesn't get better if you go to Portuguese. So it's still a dark continent when it comes to knowledge. And lastly, I want to show you Arabic. It's a language which is spoken natively by almost 500 million people, right? And this is how much you can learn. So what I want to convey with all these maps and all these languages is that Wikipedia is incomplete, and we need to step back and understand how to change that. So let's step back. We are looking at demand. Basically, Wikipedia is a project that is thriving for having coverage in as many as languages as possible. We're talking about more than 2,000 languages, spoken languages in the world today. We know that 50% of the world's population is monolingual, and these people will need to read and access knowledge in their language. And we also know that the next billion users are coming in as we speak now. So these are users that are coming most of the time from places in which we don't have good Wikipedia coverage. What's happening on the supply end? So articles are created at a rate of 6,500 per day. This is massive across all languages of Wikipedia. 60,000 active editors come from all over the world, and these are volunteers who contribute to Wikipedia. And by the way, I should mention that this number has not changed in the past couple of years. So we had a period of decline, and it's right now plateaued. It sometimes goes up a little bit, but it is a challenge that we only have 60,000 people who are responsible for the production of content and maintenance of content on Wikipedia. Yeah, so the question is, are the 6,500 articles new articles, or these are the articles that are being modified? And the answer is, these are the articles that are being created every day, added to Wikipedia. So some of them may not survive, depending on the language that they get added to, because there are notability issues and all that. So what eventually remains is a different question, but this is how much roughly that gets added to Wikipedia every day. In monitoring process, you may lose some of that. And we also know that 14,000 new accounts are being created every month on Wikipedia. So the question ahead of us is, how do we make access to all human knowledge possible on Wikipedia? And I want to talk to you in the first half of the talk about the project that is trying to address part of this problem. So the goal in general for the research team that I'm working with is to increase article coverage in two sense. In terms of the number of articles that are presented in Wikipedia, but also in terms of the content that is available in the articles that already exist on Wikipedia. We want to do this by identifying and prioritizing missing content on Wikipedia, and we want to route attention of editors, these can be newcomers or already existing editors on Wikipedia, to these prioritized list of missing content on Wikipedia. Our goal is to change the extent of knowledge on Wikipedia, so, and the rate at which it gets added to it. So if at the moment the knowledge in language X is this, if you don't do anything, we expect for the knowledge to grow that much. If we do something, we hope that we can extend the article creation rate and content creation rate on Wikipedia. Okay, so this is the first project that I'd like to talk to you about, and I will talk about this part more extensively. It's about growing Wikipedia by recommending what articles to be created. This is a joint work with Ellery Wilkshin, Bob West, and Yuri Leskovitz at Stanford. So our goal here is to recommend important missing articles to be created. And we do this by designing a system. What this system does is that it finds missing articles, it ranks them, and then it recommends them to editor based on their interests and expertise. We run a large-scale in vivo experiment on Wikipedia, and we learned through that experiment that I will show you later that we can triple the article creation rate on Wikipedia if we use this system without loss in content quality. So before talking to you about the experiment, I want to talk to you a little bit about this system, because that's kind of the underlying structure that helps us run the experiment and show the results. So the first step is finding missing articles. You have two ways for finding missing articles. One of them would be to look at the language. And by the way, for the rest of this talk, I focus on French Wikipedia as a language that we want to expand. Because the experiment was done on French Wikipedia. So let's just have our priors that we want to expand content on French Wikipedia. And what we can do is that we can compare the currently available articles on French Wikipedia with external repositories. For example, with other encyclopedias or with other sources of knowledge that are available out there, and we can compare to see what's missing. The other thing you can do is that you can compare French Wikipedia with all the other language editions of Wikipedia that are already available. What we did is that we used the second approach, and the first one has its own merits. I will come back to it in the discussion. So in order to compare French Wikipedia articles with the rest of Wikipedia, we need to have a way to go beyond the articles at the language level. And that's where Wikidata comes in. Wikidata is a knowledge base for Wikipedia. It's a project that is run by volunteers, and content is created similar to the way content is created on Wikipedia, but this time on Wikidata. You can think of Wikidata as basically a database for Wikipedia. So let me give you an example. So here you can have, you have Apple, the article about Apple on Dutch Wikipedia, you have the article about Apple on English Wikipedia, and you have the article about Apple in Slovenian Wikipedia. What Wikidata does is that it maps all of these articles to one concept, and that's Q89. That's a code for Apple on Wikidata. So this is the work that has been done by volunteers, mapping all of the articles to concepts in Wikidata. And this empowers us to not worry about specific languages and then just go at the concept level and find all the languages that contain an article about Apple. So what does it mean? This basically means that we have two layers. We have one layer, the top layer, which are concepts on Wikidata, and we have another layer down here, which are Wikipedia articles. Every Wikipedia article is represented by a concept in Wikidata. So you see, for example, Apple, this is a hypothetical example. Apple is mapped to the concept Q89. This is on English Wikipedia. In French Wikipedia, you see that university from French Wikipedia and English Wikipedia are both mapped to that other concept. By looking at Wikidata concepts, what you can figure out is that, okay, Apple is available on English Wikipedia, but it's missing on French Wikipedia. So in some sense, Wikidata helps us create some abstraction that can help us find missing content across languages. And this is how we find actually missing content in French Wikipedia. Now, the issue is ranking. So if you compare English Wikipedia with French Wikipedia, what you learn is that there are 3.7 million articles that are available on English Wikipedia, but are missing in French Wikipedia. Now, this is a very large number, and there are two problems with it. One is that we don't have enough editors who can contribute to 3.7 million articles. So we need to prioritize this task. But also another problem is that not every article that is available on English Wikipedia and is missing on French Wikipedia should exist on French Wikipedia. French Wikipedia audience may have notability constraints, but also may have French speakers or the people who are reading content in French may need different needs than the people who are reading English Wikipedia. So we need to do the ranking. So the goal here is that given a missing article in French Wikipedia, I want to be able to predict the popularity rank of this missing article in that language. Right? And you quickly see what is the challenge here. The challenge is that the article does not exist in French Wikipedia. So how are we going to find any feature related to that article in French Wikipedia? Right? So here is how we solve the problem. We predict popularity of existing French Wikipedia articles based on the features from articles that are outside of French Wikipedia. This will allow us that when we go to articles that don't exist on French Wikipedia, to be able to use those features from outside of French Wikipedia to predict the popularity of the missing articles. So there are features that we have used for doing this, and here is the list of them. So basically, we looked at the page views in the source language. So let's say source is English in this case. We looked at the page views of article Apple in English. We also looked at geo-page views. So we have the page views per country that come to the article Apple. So this geo-page view can give us a sense of how international this concept is. So the idea here, basically the intuition is that if you have an article that is only read by the people who are coming from the US, this article may not be very relevant to the people who are sitting in Paris and reading articles in French Wikipedia. We also included quality classes, topics, inward and outward links to the articles, the edit activity. Here, the idea would be that if there's a lot of edit activity on an article, then this article can potentially be more popular. And then number of Wikipedia languages that already contain that article, with the reasoning that if there are already 40 Wikipedias that have that article, probably the 41 also should have it. And then we tested a variety of classification algorithms, and we eventually settled with random forest. So we tried linear regression, ridge regression, and a few more. Random forest did the best in our case. So what we have done through this step is basically using machine learning to build a prediction model that can rank missing the 3.7 million missing articles based on their popularity if they were existing on French Wikipedia. So we found the missing articles, we ranked them. Now the question is, we have to recommend them. And we have to recommend them to editors based on their interests. So let me explain to you how we did this. So we solved this problem basically by solving a bipartite matching problem. So on the left-hand side, you see the editors. You have E1, E2, all the way to E, however many thousand editors you have in the language you're talking about, in this case, French. And we also listed the top missing articles. Note that I put the concepts from Wikidata here, but you can think of them as basically articles in French Wikipedia. Each editor is connected to every article because there's a possibility of the editor basically creating that article. But then the edges have weights. And these weights are what we call affinity of editor to that topic or to that article. For now, let's assume the affinities are given to us. I'm going to explain in the following slides how we compute them. So in this bipartite matching problem, C is basically the affinity matrix of the editor to the article. And what the bipartite matching problem allows us to do is a few things. One is that we want to make sure that we recommend each article to only one editor. This is part of it is because of the constraints we have in the system right now. We don't have a good way for people to stack tasks, which means if you recommend one article to two people and they both of them start working on them in draft mode, you will have frustrated people who want to at some point publish the article, and it turns out the article already exists or somebody else is working on it. So we want to make sure each article is recommended to one person. We also want to make sure that we have some control over how many articles we are recommending to each person. So here, K on the bipartite matching problem is basically the number of articles we recommend to the editor. And we want to make sure every editor receives those many recommendations. And lastly, we also know that this bipartite matching problem with affinity as the weight will allow us to maximize for the sum of total affinities across all editors and all articles, which is a desirable objective function. The right-hand side bipartite matching problem is basically a linear programming problem, and you can solve it. So now the question is, remember we had 3.7 million articles, right? So here you have a list of 3.7 million articles, and the matching problem will be applied on that 3.7 million. But if we do that, there's a chance that something from the bottom of that list gets recommended to an editor. So we need to find a way to say, in that ranked list, what is important? And this is something that we don't have a perfect answer for, but we have a good enough answer for now. What we did is that we defined a threshold. So we basically said, cut that list of 3.7 million articles and take the top of them. And top can be, let's say, 300,000 articles. Right? So the key is that we apply the bipartite matching on a subset, which is a ranked subset of all the articles that are missing. Okay, so now let me explain to you how we computed the affinities. Remember that the affinity is basically how much an editor, E1, likes to edit an article Q3-4, basically. So in order to do this, we need to find a mapping between the concepts from Wikidata on a space, right? So what we do is that we do a semantic vector space mapping. Here you see a two-dimensional mapping of Wikidata items, missing Wikidata items corresponding to missing articles. So suppose these are four articles that are missing, these are four articles, and this is their space This is the vector space mapping of these articles. And there are different approaches for doing this mapping. And what we used was basically DLDA models. There are more recent methods that you can use. For example, you can use the neural network-based models, and such as vector vector-to-vector. But we went with LDA here. So now, how does this work? Suppose you have an editor, E1, who has edited these three concepts or these three articles. So you can take an average of these vectors, vector representations of those three articles, and represent E1 by the average of those vectors. Now, suppose we want to see how how much will E1 be interested in editing this new article. And we compute that by basically computing the cosine similarity between E1's vector and Q34's vector representation. That's how we compute affinity. So by explaining how we compute affinity, we are done with the kind of the recommendation component. We now have a bipartite matching problem. We know how to compute affinities. We do that, and we do the recommendation, and it's done. Now the question is, Sorry, let me just summarize before talking about the experiment. So basically what I've showed you is that we have a way for finding missing articles using a combination of Wikipedia and Wikidata. Then we have a way for ranking the missing articles. And then we also know how to match missing articles to editors based on their interests. Now, let me show you how well this approach actually works in practice. So we ran an experiment on French Wikipedia using French Wikipedia as the destination Wikipedia and English Wikipedia as the source Wikipedia. What we did is that we sent out 12,000 emails to editors of French Wikipedia. Each of them received 5 recommendations. Now, I'll explain this in more detail later, but basically, some of them received randomized recommendations and some of them received personalized recommendations. And we also use translation as a way for encouraging editors to contribute. These editors had contributed both to English and French Wikipedia, so we knew that they know the two languages, at least to some extent, well. So we encouraged them to basically use translation for these recommendations. And we had 3 specific research questions when we went to this experiment. We wanted to know whether recommendations boost article creation at all, how much does personalization help, and how do recommendations affect article quality? All 3 are important questions because we need to invest, and we need, if you want to do personalization, this is going to be a bigger investment on our end in terms of resources. And also in terms of quality, it's important for us not to create systems that can reduce the quality on Wikipedia. It should be at least as good as what it is right now. Okay, so let me show you how we did this. So we had the top 300,000 articles that were available in English Wikipedia but missing in French Wikipedia. And we had already ranked them, so we went to the top of that list and took the first 300,000. Then we randomly sampled 100,000 from each, and we created these 3 sets. We also have 3 sets of editors. The 12,000 who have received the recommendations, these we have divided them into 2 parts, 6,000 each, and all the other editors who can contribute to Wikipedia but have not received, are not going to receive any recommendations from us. So for the first group, we took randomly articles from the first 100,000, randomly selected articles, and then we did personalization using the bipartite matching, and we recommended 5 articles to editors in that group. In the second group, we still took the 100,000 articles which were part of the important articles classified by our ranking model, but then we randomly assigned them to editors. And by random, we mean this is not personalized based on their interest. These are still important articles, but are not personalized to them. And this other 100,000, we call them held back. So this is basically a set that we set aside, and we said, okay, we're not gonna touch this, we're gonna see what happens organically on this set, right? So you have all the other editors and all these articles that they could edit. Of course, they could also edit from the other batches, but this is how we are going to measure the organic growth. So we contacted humans, and we contacted a lot of humans. And when you do that, you receive feedback. And feedback is sometimes nice, sometimes not nice. So there are people who got back to us with enthusiastic and very supportive notes, but there are also people who are not happy about receiving emails. And here are some notes about them. The first one, what are you doing? Trying to scare contributors away from Wikipedia. Congratulations, you're doing a fine job. Great way to waste donors' money. And then you also get feedback like, I know how hard it is to work with 70,000 backseat drivers, so I think you deserve some nice work. Or, oh, I forgot to tell you that I find the idea nice, perhaps even brilliant. This was a person who has also provided some feedback on how we can improve the system. So this was definitely interesting to go through. It was also interesting for us to see that this came up. The issue of language imperialism, so the fact that we used English Wikipedia as a source to recommend to French Wikipedia was considered by some as imperialism, of like enforcing one language to another language, something that we can talk about in the Q&A. We try to have part of the recommendation system built in a way to capture some of the issues that can come up with this, but it's important to keep this in mind, that this is a real problem that editors are concerned about. Okay, so the first research question, whether boosting article creation rate actually happens. So in order to measure this, we looked at the personalized recommendations versus the articles that were recommended basically using the personalization versus the batch that was not recommended at all. Right? So we wanted to see if we don't do any recommendation versus if we do personalized recommendation, what kind of a difference can we create? And then we look at article creation rates, and there's a specific definition for this. This is the probability that the article gets created up to 1 month after we have recommended it to the user. So what you can see here is that, yes, personalized recommendations work, and they can actually increase article creation rate by a factor of 3.2. So this was a good news, because it was not actually clear to us if this is going to happen. If you just send emails to people and say, do something, people are free souls, they're doing this on their volunteer time, they can do whatever they want to do, they may just delete the email and do nothing. But they did actually something with this. The next question is, does personalization help? And for doing this, we compared the personalized versus random components, and then what we measured was activation rate. This was the probability that the editor does one edit, basically starts creating the article that is being recommended to them. And what we learned is that, yes, personalized recommendations are better than random recommendations, and they can actually increase the activation rate by a factor of 2. And lastly, we look at the impact on article quality. So these are the different levels of article quality considered on English Wikipedia, and also used in many of the other language Wikipedias. Stop, good start, well built, all the way to featured article that you can think of as kind of the best state an article can get into in terms of quality rankings that are available. And what we see here is that there's no loss in quality. So there are minor differences between organic growth and the recommended growth when you look at the quality of the articles. Okay, so we were happy with the results, and we did a few things with it. We developed a public API for translation recommendations. The link to it is in the slides. If you want to look it up, build tools on it, do anything that you want with it, by all means. We also offered the service, which is offered by the public API, to one of the tools that is being developed by the foundation. It's called Content Translation Tool. It has a feature which is called Suggestions. At the moment, 150 articles get published every week using the Suggestions feature, which is backed by the API. And then we also developed this tool called Gap Finder. The goal of the tool is beyond just article creation, but for at the moment, here is how the tool looks like. Suppose I'm a Persian speaker, which I am, and suppose I know English, and suppose I'm interested in agriculture. What I can do is that I can go to this tool, type agriculture in the search bar, and what I will see is recommendations for articles that exist in English Wikipedia but missing in French Wikipedia. So this is now more of a pull model. You want the editor to go somewhere, we don't want to push them emails constantly. They can go somewhere and they provide a seed and they receive recommendations. So you actually can see that crop rotation article, for example, is missing on Persian Wikipedia, and you can start creating that. There's an example about climate change in Malagasy language. So as you know, Madagascar is one of the places that is predicted to be heavily affected by climate change. And Malagasy, which is the prominent language spoken by the people of Madagascar, is a small language on English Wikipedia. If you type climate change in Gap Finder, you can see that things as simple as greenhouse gas or, you know, climate change itself are missing from the language. So you can actually start making a change for the people. Or if you are from Madagascar, you can start creating these articles in your language. Okay, so basically, to conclude this part, there are massive knowledge gaps on Wikipedia. And we built an end-to-end system, and then we experimented with it. And we showed that using this end-to-end system, you can increase the article creation rate in Wikipedia by a factor of more than 3 without losing quality. And then there are tools and public APIs that you can use to access some of the work. So let me briefly give you kind of a sneak peek into the next thing we're working on, and then we can switch to questions in a few minutes. So this is one of the maps that we started from, right? And what can happen in the best case? If the result of our first research is completely successful, if we also include external repositories, what can happen is that this map can turn pretty white. But this map is not telling you the whole story, right? What it's telling you is whether the article exists or not, but it doesn't tell you how much knowledge is available or how much content is available in that article. So even in the best case that this map is all white, we have a lot to do. And that's the second project that we're working on right now. This is a very early stage project. I'm just telling you just so you have a sense, things may change rapidly in this space. This is a joint work with Tiziano Picardi, Bob West, and Michele Catasta from EPFL on article expansion recommendations. So here is the overview of the system. There are more than 2 million articles on English Wikipedia that are stubs. Stubs are very short articles, usually considered less than 1,500 characters. This is 37% of all articles that exist on English Wikipedia. Many of the articles that are not tagged as stubs are still incomplete. I'm sure many of you have experienced, you were searching for something, you went to Wikipedia, many times you find what you're looking for, but many times you see things missing. We all experience it. On the other hand, you have the community of Wikipedia editors or edithon organizers. We heard about them. They have an event here on March 21st. These people organize edithons, hundreds of edithons across the year, to do two things mainly. They want to expand articles' content across languages, but they also want to bring newcomers to Wikipedia. So please go to the March 21st event. So the challenge on the participant end is that if you're a newcomer or a less experienced Wikipedia editor, it is not actually obvious what you should add to an existing article. On the organizer end, the challenge is that the topics to be provided to new editors or less experienced editors is already a manual task. So people actually dig Wikipedia pages, use the category system, but it's a very manual task to create lists of what needs to be expanded. But also, they want to provide some guidelines to the people who come to these edithons. And that's a very manual task too. So basically, you're talking about a variety of Wikipedia articles, as like biographies, movies, cities. These articles have different structures, different characteristics. These characteristics change from one language to the next. So in a very resource, almost I want to say deprived environment, that you have very few editors or organizers who are contributing to Wikipedia, this is a huge challenge. So what we did is that we defined this as our problem. It's not a specific research question yet, but this is the problem that we're trying to address. There's lack of scalable and language-independent methodologies for generating guidelines for contributors, especially for newcomers, to help them expand articles. And this is what we want to address. So let me show you an example, and then close the talk with this. I'm from Iran, and Sanandaj is a city in the northwestern part of Iran. It's a Kurdish city. And I checked Sanandaj's article on English Wikipedia this morning. It is the capital of Kurdistan, a province of Kurdistan, so it is a big deal. It has 4 sections. if you look at this article on English Wikipedia, two of them are references and external links, which appear on pretty much all Wikipedia articles. So this article technically has two sections, right? So if you put this article in front of me and say, expand it, and I don't know anything, how would I know what sections are usually available in Wikipedia articles that are about cities? So what I did is that I checked the article about Tehran on English Wikipedia. So what you can see is that there are actually many more sections that can be added for a capital of a city. Of course, Tehran is a bigger city, so you may have more stuff to talk about. But still, this is one of the top 10 big cities in Iran with more than 300,000 people living in it. It's a very important, strategically important city with a lot of culture and cuisine and all of that. So two sections, I would not buy it. And then what the other thing you can do is that you can look at Persian Wikipedia. And I appreciate that many of you cannot read here, but these are sections, believe me. And there are actually sections that are available there, but they are not available on the English Wikipedia version. And this is, by the way, for the article about Sanandaj. So basically, our goal is to expand articles across languages. And one of the units of recommendations that we are looking for right now is article sections. There are, of course, other things that you can recommend, but as a first thing, we want to focus on sections and see if we can provide recommendations to editors as what sections to add to Wikipedia. There's a simple intuition here, and that is basically co-occurrence of sections within a project or co-occurrence of sections outside of a language project are a strong signal. We're testing with market basket analysis, and what we are seeing is that you can actually learn some things by looking at the frequency of sections. So for example, if you're interested in expanding an article which is about a movie, and the article already has sections on production, cast, release, and reception, we can tell you that with 85% probability, this article should also have a section which is called plot. That's already helpful. So we're doing some experiment in that space. We're also looking at other types of articles, and we're trying to develop models that are language independent, taking into account the needs of the language, but easily scalable across languages. So let me talk to you about the next steps and open questions. Basically, one of the things we want to do is to improve the algorithms. These recommendation algorithms at the moment are not taking into account the feedback from the user. So basically, if the user say, no, I'm not interested about this topic, or no, this article should not be created in my language, this feedback is being collected, but we don't have a loop back to the algorithm. There's also the issue of article importance. In the first research that we did, we considered popularity to be a measure of article importance. We used features that can be more localized, but still, there's a valid point to say importance on an encyclopedic content is not necessarily popularity. So as an educational project, Wikipedia may have other ways for defining what is important. There's interest to go beyond just user interest to do recommendations. So for example, if I get what topics you're interested in, but all you're doing is typo fixing, that's very different than if you're creating articles. And we need to take that into account when we're giving you recommendations. And then the last thing is expanding on how we find missing articles. At the moment, we are looking inside Wikipedia and across languages, but there is definitely value about like going outside of Wikipedia and figuring out what we are missing that we are not aware of. With that, I close, and thank you.
Thank you. So we have a few minutes for questions. Who would like to pose a question?
So thank you for the talk. I'm not a Wikipedia editor or anything like that, but I wondered to what extent you, for example, you had this pointer to Q89 earlier on, which was like this captured the topic, mm-hmm. and I just wondered to what extent automated systems could generate, I guess, what you called stubs. And then perhaps people that were looking in another language, for example, would go to the stub, and perhaps combine that with the fact that it might be a trend, if, you know, could you translate then from one language to another, mm-hmm. rather than having an expert in the topic per se?
Right. That's a very good question. And there is no one answer to it. So if you ask different people, they have different opinions about the issue of stubs. And this is different from one language to the other. Generally, the trend in most of the languages is that you don't want to have a lot of stubs. Because a lot of stubs in your language gives this impression potentially to the reader of Wikipedia that, oh, this is a low quality thing. There's nothing here that is complete. So there is a line of argument that says it's better not to have some things than have them in masses that are incomplete. So the other issue with creating a lot of stubs is that you usually want to grow your content as fast as you can grow your community. So if there's nobody to maintain those pages, why to create them? Because then you're going to be in this trouble that somebody can go and change it, and then you can't maintain it. This being said, there are projects like GeneWiki project that have experimented with automatically generating articles on Wikipedia, the gene and protein articles on Wikipedia, using Wikidata information. So they get that information and they generate at least the info boxes and like some of the descriptions automatically. Again, like this is project by project, language by language, it can be different.
You sort of touched on it before throughout the talk, but where does translation fit in? I mean, in terms of just doing kind of a relative to this, a brute force, but perhaps effective technique of just hooking up potential translators with filling in mutually back and forth across languages.
Right, and you're not talking about automatic translators, translation, right? No, you're talking about human. Yeah, so this is not something that we have systematically approached. There are definitely people on Wikipedia who do a lot of translations, Wikipedia editors that do translations, but this is not something which is systematically necessarily encouraged. There's a tool which is developed by the Wikimedia Foundation, content translation, which is making it easier for people to translate, so that can be a source kind of to bring more translators, but nothing beyond that. The editor community also, I should say, they organize specific editathon on translations from time to time. So these are the efforts which are available.
So I'm gonna take the prerogative of the last question perhaps and ask, I know that the number of editors on Wikipedia who are women is something around 10%, is that right? It's a very low number of participants who are women. I wondered if Wikipedia had any efforts to reach out to that community specifically, like the editathon next week, I think is specifically marketed around gender and trying to reach out to women to participate more in the Wikipedia community. I wonder if you could speak to that.
Yeah, so on the statistics, I must say that it's between, on English Wikipedia, it's between 10 to 15%, but this is based on the people who self-report. Self-reporting can have all sorts of problems in it. You go to events and you see very few women in general. So there are signals that it's really low. How low exactly, I'm not sure if it's like 10%, 15%, or worse or better. Definitely it's not 50%. The efforts that are organized around it, so the community is aware of this, Wikipedia community. So there is this gender gap task force, which is focused on diversifying the contributor pool on Wikipedia. So that's on the community end. There are editathons that are being organized, as you mentioned, to improve that. But there are also on Wikimedia Foundation, and this has received a lot of attention. There's a project that I'm hoping to start on working soon, and that's on basically trying to understand how we can address some of the causes that can reduce contributor diversity, specifically gender gap, for example, the issue of confidence, self-confidence. Mm. So we're designing some experiments to see how we can play with that and whether we see if we can change anything. But that's an issue that it's definitely an important one, and it's being considered.
Great. Thank you. Well, please join me in thanking our speaker.
Thank you.